Okay, in all seriousness, there are a lot of disaster films out there. Some of them were really good, some of them, meh, some of them are timeless. They all seem to have the general thinking. There is this big thing that is happening to Earth, but there's always like a smaller story at play. Family and redemption and things. And a perfectly good disaster movie must end with some sort of moral, you know, like we're all one people, or it doesn't matter who we are on the outside, we are all, you know, human beings trying to stay alive and all that crap. So anyway, I've put together my top five disaster movies. Suicide Squad is a disaster movie. That movie, first of all, was a disaster to begin with, and it is a disaster movie. I could watch maybe the first 45 minutes of Suicide Squad, and then it becomes this wholly chopped up, rushed, edited, you know, thing where, you know, I think it's Detroit. All of Detroit is in a mess. You know, you have to save Amanda Waller, and the idea that it's Amanda Waller that needs saving, it just doesn't gel. And then if you flow through the movie, there's like this whole ring of dirt in the sky, and oh god, it's a disaster movie.
Everybody down!
So San Andreas never really did anything for me, but I added here into this honorable mention list because, you know, in terms of recent memory, it's a cool enough disaster movie. Way better than Geostorm. Do not watch Geostorm. Oh my god.
Pierce Brosnan. Linda Hamilton.
Oh my god.
Dante's Peak. The pressure is building.
Dante's Peak was kind of a toss-up for me because there is another film that I think came out around the same time. And I have it there in my top five. But it was kind of, who deserves the top five spot more? Pierce Brosnan or that particular movie? And I think that movie got it better. Yes, it's Linda Hamilton. Yes, it's Future Bond. But I don't know, it's good, but it's not, you know, great.
Gadget out of town. Let's do it.
This movie, for me, it was kind of hard putting it in the honorable mention category because the core is like this really, really good film. And when you hear what my top five are, you might actually gripe about it and tell me, well, you know, you're going to take that out and put the core in. Aaron Eckhart is like this young scientist. This is years before Dark Knight comes out. Hilary Swank is a pilot. You know, they had to go to this guy who built a spaceship, a ship, so that they could dive into this hot place and survive. It was really, really good, but, you know, it didn't make my top five. The First Avengers and Man of Steel. The destruction upon the planet / Metropolis that came out from both of those films was Right, that is a disaster flick happening there. Now, very quickly, let's go into my top five disaster movies, in my opinion, of all time.
Save as many as you can.
Day After Tomorrow is a climate change movie. You know, you got politicians denying the fact that climate change is a thing, or in their personal belief system, you know, it's not going to affect them in their lifetime, so why fret about it? You know, it could be that the Earth could be destroyed tomorrow, or it could be destroyed 500 million years from now. Climate change, what's that about? And funny enough, we're in that kind of position right now. There's a lot of climate change deniers within all governments. So it kind of still has resonance. Anybody who remembers 2012 as an idea was that's supposed to be that whole the Mayans finished doing their calendar and the Earth was going to end and stuff. And I like that it was topical. It took the idea of, haha, 2012, nobody's really believing in that, and made it into this huge scale disaster movie.
Stay calm.
Now, Volcano for me was the other half of Dante's Peak, but it really came down to Tommy Lee Jones versus Pierce Brosnan, and I really prefer Tommy Lee Jones in this flick. Pain and destruction and trying to outrun lava. Good Lord. I don't know scientifically if it's possible. I think it would be possible. I mean, if you have enough earthquake, you know, molten lava can come up from that thing. So, and Tommy Lee Jones and Anne Hesch really played off nicely over each other.
Should we win the day, the 4th of July will no longer be known as an American holiday, but as the day when the world declared in one voice, we will not go quietly into the night. We will not vanish without a fight. We're going to live on. We're going to survive. Today, we celebrate our Independence Day.
Now, if you want to figure out what really makes Independence Day really great, watch this dog scene. I mean, come on, you have to save the dog. No matter what the natural disaster or unnatural disaster, to this day, whenever I'm watching like Fox or TNT or whoever is playing it, I legitimately still go like this, like, get the dog, get the dog. Which is why Independence Day Resurgence is so much of a letdown. Like, I waited 20 years for this film. For a movie that came out in like 2016 or 17, somewhere around there, it doesn't hold up as much as this first film, this first Independence Day. You still root for Will Smith. People still quote the president's speech. Because it's Jeff Goldblum. Primarily because the aliens don't want to talk to us. We're pretty lame. Right, okay, so here's my number one. My number one disaster movie. Okay, so a young journalist, Tia Looney, she finds out about this story about Ellie, and there is a senator who, you know, resigns because of something that's going on with Ellie, and she thinks she's, you know, that the senator had an affair, so she's about to break this story about Ellie. And then, you know, the president corners her with his people and starts talking about the ELE event. So she doesn't really know what it is, but she goes back to her office and starts researching about it, only to realize that ELE stands for Extinction Level Event. Why? Because there is an asteroid. There are, in fact, two asteroids that are coming towards Earth, and it's going to rain havoc upon us. It's going to do to us the same thing that that asteroid did to the dinosaurs, and we would become like squiggly, you know, oil gelatin creatures. Well, okay, they didn't say that last part, but you get the idea. That's exactly what happened. Boom! Destruction! Deep Impact did a lot of things. Deep Impact showed us, you know, a black president. In fact, to be honest with you, there was only two times that I actively remember seeing a black president. One was in Deep Impact and the other one was in 24. Deep Impact has kind of like three stories. You got the major story, which is, okay, all hell's about to break loose, we're about to die, the planet's about to be destroyed. But then you also have like other little stories at play. You have the astronauts who are up there who, spoiler alert, they also die saving us. And it's led by Robert Duvall. He's like this old Neil Armstrong type astronaut who is gone up there with these young people, and they have to do whatever it takes to sort of get these asteroids off course so that it doesn't come and inflict, like extinction level event damage upon us. How do you deal with that kind of scene? Then you also have the other story where, to preserve life, the government started having like an ark, and people who are over a certain age aren't going to be able to enter that. Maybe people for whom, you know, the nations of the earth think that they have value. So imagine you're like a 55-year-old scientist and your best friend is a 55-year-old janitor. You might actually be allowed to, you know, get on the ark or something, but the other person mightn't. There was a lottery system. One of the main cast members was Elijah Wood, and he's like this 16-year-old, and he's in love with this girl, and her parents ends up, you know, not being able to be part of the group that would be saved. And there's this scene where, you know, the mother takes the child and gives it to the girl and Elijah, and like, they have to save this child from destruction while like water is coming to destroy everybody. Stuff like that.
Good luck to us all.
And I don't care how many times I've seen it, that scene coming on towards the end where Tia Looney and her estranged father, and she's hugging him as this tidal wave comes up, and all she says is,
"Daddy."
This is such a good movie. Okay, enough of that crap. The point is, Deep Impact manages to sustain itself. It still holds up today, and that's what I look for when I'm scanning through the TV stations or checking my DVD collection to see what I actually want to watch. If I come across Deep Impact, I don't mind sitting down and watching it again because it holds up, the acting holds up, the storyline holds up. So yeah, those are my top five disaster flicks. Finally, in closing, do make sure and have a go bag. A normal go bag will work. So in case anything does happen, you know, you just grab that bag and you're able to go. But if you are a nerd, you need to pack a nerd go bag. My nerd go bag has
yeah.
I also have my small laptop in there, and I'm always going to make sure I have my memory stick. My small laptop can hold a charge, so you know, maybe, you know, you might get electricity for 1 hour of the day, but at least I can have it charged enough beforehand, so when it's absolutely necessary, I can plug in my memory stick and watch a movie or watch something from before life went completely bonkers. These are the things to have. That's it. That's it. Those are my top five disaster flicks. That's my little piece of advice to you. Stay safe. Make sure and pack a go bag. Make sure and have your nerd go bag. And sound in. Tell me, what are your favorite disaster flicks? Is it something here on the list? Is it something that's not on the list? Let me know in the comments below. And as always, don't forget to subscribe. Bye.